Hi everyone, in this video I'll be talking about the introduction of Airflow. So this is the first video in a tutorial series. The goal of this video is to answer two questions. What is Airflow and why do we need Airflow? So let's go to the first question. What is Airflow? Airflow is a platform to programmatically alter, schedule, and monitor workflow or data pipelines. So what is a workflow? A workflow is a sequence of tasks started on a schedule or triggered by an event and frequently used to handle big data processing pipelines. So this is an example of typical workflow. When the first task is you need to download data from a source, right? And then you need to send data somewhere else to process. In the middle, you need to monitor how the process is running. After the process is completed, you need to generate a report. And finally, you need to send a report out by email. So in a traditional ETL approach, in the example here, when you have a database and HDFS, and you need to get the data out of the database and load it into HDFS to process. So a naive approach is you write a script. And in the script, you specify, multiple tasks. For example, the first task is connect to the database, second task is to pull data from the database, and the third task is to send the data to HDFS to process. And if you want to schedule the script, you schedule it at a cron job. Either it is a daily or an hourly script, depends on your need. So there's multiple problems with this naive approach. The first one is failure. How do you handle failure? It is way better if the process is retried if failure happens, right? But then how many times? And how often do you want it to retry? The second problem is monitoring. How do you keep track of the status of each task? And how do you keep track of how long each task runs? What if one task taking too long to run? The third problem is dependency. The data dependency issue is, for example, if you have upstream data is missing. In this case, you don't want the downstream task to run, right? Another problem with dependency is called execution dependency. In this case, you have two cron jobs. And for example, cron job one taking an hour to run, you schedule it at 1 a.m. and you expect it to run to finish at 2 a.m. So you schedule the second one, job two, at 2:30. So you have a buffer of 30 minutes. But at some point, for example, at one day, job one takes 2 hours to run. That means the cron job two is started before the job one is finished. So that's the execution dependency issue. Another issue is scalability. So you have a machine, you put in multiple cron job, and at one point you need more and more cron job to scale up the machine, but at one point you need to scale out. I mean, you have another machine and another machine to schedule more and more cron job. Then you have no centralized scheduler between multiple cron machines, right? Another issue is deployment. How do you keep track or maintain of all the new changes and the new deployment of the new changes that constantly happen? And the final problem is, how do you process historical data? And this is the regular need of all the big data company. I mean, you need to backfill or rerun historical data to generate all the report so that you compare. For example, you compare the report of 6 months ago until now, you see any like upward or downward trend in a report or something like that. All the problem I told you will be handled nicely by Airflow. So Airflow is a workflow or data pipeline management system developed by Airbnb. It is a framework to define tasks and dependency written in Python, and you can write all the tasks and dependency in Python as well. It can execute, schedule, and distribute tasks across worker nodes. That means it takes care of the scalability issues that I told you earlier. It gives you a view of present and past run. That means all the historical run and the login feature. It can be extensible to plugins and have a very nice UI, and you can interact with it through REST interface and interact very well with all the major cloud or database system. It joined the Apache Software Foundation Incubation Program in 2016, That means it has a huge community support the project. It is currently an open source project and is used by more than 200 companies and all big data companies like Airbnb, Yahoo, PayPal, Intel, Stripe, Google. They all use Airflow internally. So it's very exciting. So a workflow in Airflow is described as a directed acyclic graph, or in short, you can call it a DAC. And a DAC is composed of tasks. So you can see this is an example of a DAC or a workflow. And each of the rectangular box here is a task. So you start at one point and you end at one point. And first it will run this first task here, and then it reaches all the tasks in section one. All of this will be run in parallel. And then this one, the sum of the tasks in the middle, will wait for all this one to finish. So this is an execution graph or a dependency graph, you can say it as well. And you can monitor it in real time. You can see all this run in parallel, and this one will wait for all this run before this one run. And all the data will flow through. Think of it as like a river. Like all this is all the branch, and if it all the data flowing through all these branch before it reached the ocean. The thing of it is like that. So let's go to a quick demo, right? So in this case here, I have two DAC. One is called example Twitter DAC, and one is called tutorial. So in a example Twitter DAC, if you take a look at graph wheel, in the example, for example, I try to fetch some Twitter data, I clean the Twitter a tweet and analyze tweet, and then I put into HDFS, and all this you can see, like, you know, you just look at the dependency graph on the DAC here. Each of the rectangular box is a task, and you can see it give you a very nice UI that all this one will run in parallel and wait for this one finished. And let's run through the tutorial, because this is a simple graph and I can explain it to you. You can either run it manually by click here to trigger that to run manually. On this case, I just click turn on the scheduler, because this is a daily schedule, and you can see immediately it run. And if you go to graph view, you can see this one success, this one is sent to queue, and this one now is success. It run very quick, right? This is just a template task. So but you can think of it, if you have like longer run tasks, so this one can take an hour to run, but you can see like this one currently running. This one wait for 5 seconds, and this sleep task, but you can think of it as like you have like an hour running task, and you can monitor in real time how the task and all the dependency tasks is flowing, right? So the graph will give you the nice representation of the execution graph and how things is flowing. In the tree view, you have a historical graph. Historical graph, that means you can go back in time. You have a starting end day, and it, you know, all the way back feel. It run to all the historical day, and you have a historical graph up for each day, each task running. That means you can click on each task. For example, this one is run on for yesterday. It run for yesterday data, November 18. So I can click on this and go to the log and can see the input and output. The input is the running command, and the output is all the output from this command, right? And it's only run one time, and you see the log by time is only one. And we go back to trivial, you can go to the second day, you know, you can go to print day, click on a log, and so you have a log for each day it run for as many day as you specify, you know, in start day and end day. And if you want to rerun, you can click on the task, click clear, okay, and this one ultimately, you know, send to the queue to rerun immediately for you. This one is a very quick task, so you can see it rerun and, you know, successfully run. But if you go to log right now, you see that log by time too. I mean, it run the second time. So this is the first time run, and keep track of a log, and this is the second time rerun, and this is the input and output of the second run. And you can think of it like if you have like a failure, for example, the first time it run and fail at some point, and you specify the retry mechanism ultimately handled by Airflow, it ultimately retry the second time, so you can go back and go to the log and keep track of the you know, the first one it run and why it fail, and you see the error right here. And the second one retry, you can see why it's a success. You know, so you can go back in time and monitor everything and keep track of the log. The Gantt graph here will tell you how long each task running. Detail will tell you, you know, start day and airflow and end day on the initialization of your graph. And the code here will give you the code that you use the code to, you know, to define your graph, your DAG or your workflow. For example, in this case, you have a tutorial DAG. You call it tutorial. You put some default argument in. This is a description of your workflow. You put a schedule of, you know, daily. And this is the first task, just run command to print the day, documentation of the first task. Second task, just sleep for 5 seconds. And third task, it's just, you know, a bash command, a templated bash command. And this is the dependency that you put, like task one run and then task two, task three depend on task one. That's why it only, you know, create the dependency or the execution graph for you. So that's a quick demo. Let's go back to the video. So what makes Airflow great? And you can see, you know, it can handle upstream downstream dependency gracefully. I mean, if the upstream data is missing, the downstream won't run. It waits for the upstream to retry successfully before all the downstream can run, right? Very easy to reprocess a historical job by day, and I can show you. That means you can go back in the historical graph to rerun any like task specific in any specific day you want in the past, and you can rerun for any specific interval you want, and you can pass parameter from upstream job to downstream. It handle error and failure gracefully for you. That means it auto retry when a task fail. Ease of deployment, integration with a lot of, you know, different infrastructure. For example, Hive, Presto, AWS, Google Cloud. I mean, the community pushes to a different level, and they put all the operator and the library is there for you to use. All you need to do, if you want to connect to different database or different cloud, you just import it, and immediately is there for you to use, so you don't have to rewrite. Data sensor, basically, you know, you have a sensor task to keep sensing if the data is there. When the data is available, it's immediately trigger DAG to run. So we've talked about it in the next video about sensor and all the concept of a DAG. Different other great feature of Airflow: job testing, accessibility of log file, trigger rule, monitoring, email alert, and the most important one is a huge community to support Airflow. So different Airflow application, data warehousing when you need to maintain the quality of your data warehouse. Machine learning is you need to write production, you know, machine learning workflow when from start to finish, like called end-to-end machine learning workflow. Like the first task, collect all the data from some different sources, do some manipulation to have a quality data before you can apply some sort of a machine learning algorithm on top to generate the model and finally serve it in production. So end-to-end machine learning, and Airflow can help you, you know, write a pipeline and schedule it to refresh your machine learning workflow daily, weekly, or monthly, depending on your case. Different application: growth analytics, A/B testing in experimentation, email targeting, search, and data infrastructure maintenance. So Airflow is amazing in a way that it helps you write production data pipeline or production data product. Let's talk briefly about a hierarchy of data science. And this is the thing that I see after I work in the design industry for more than 5 years, in a sense. So this pyramid here represents the hierarchy of data science currently need in the industry. So the Airflow framework put things into perspective, right? So in this pyramid, the bottom one is the one that currently needed the most, or the one that all the industry need. That means you need they need some sort of framework to collect data, write production ETL data pipeline so that you have a clean quality data before you can apply any sort of thing in the top of the pyramid, like analytic metrics, A-B testing, or AI deep learning, machine learning, something like that. So before a company can optimize the business more efficiently or build an intelligent data product, this layer of that foundation need to be built first. So data is the fuel for all data product. And to get data into your company, you need a production data pipeline. What I see in currently is, unfortunately, most college and data science training program only focus on the top of the pyramid. So this part is missing. And there's currently a discrepancy between the need of industry and training program in college or any design training program. So I hope this tutorial is helpful for anyone who try to fill out a gap to have a big good picture. This reached the end of the video, and in the next video I'll talk about how to set up like the Airflow environment, and we'll go through some, you know, running the first workflow and example or use cases where you understand more about a framework. So goodbye guys, and see you in the next video.